turns from darkness to light. Anytime temptation comes and someone stands to fight, anytime somebody lives to serve and not be served, I know, I know, I know, I know. God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move in many mighty ways. God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move today. Anytime in darkness someone falls upon their knees or dares to speak the truth that sets men free, anytime the choice is made to stand upon the word, I know, I know, I know, I know that God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move in many mighty ways. God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move today. A searching soul, and someone says, send me, here I go. I know, I know, I know, I know. God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move in many mighty ways. God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move today.
Welcome, welcome. Please, everyone, stand and let's raise our voices to worship our King.
The song is House of the Lord, and it's found on your sheet inside your bulletin.
We shall. everyone. It's great to see you. And speaking of, we won't be quiet and we shout out your praise. We have some campers here, and they're going to do a couple of the music things that we did this week in worship. So congregation can be seated, and I think counselors can be seated. And everybody else can bring their drums up onto the pew. Okay, so one of the very fun things that we did this week was play the bucket drums. And we have a chant that's called Jesus Was a Cool Dude. And the campers are going to do that for you now. And then after that, they're going to come up on the steps and do another song, sign language. All right, so everybody ready? 4, 3, 2, 1. Boys and girls, so put your drums down, and while you're coming up quietly, Miss Karen's going to say a few things.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you. For those of you who have shared your kiddos with us for the past week, thank you so much. We love having them. We're having so much fun with them, and we look forward to a great week, too. Now, as you can imagine, camp takes a lot of people to make it happen. And so right now, I just want to give a quick shout out to all of those who make camp happen. So if you are a junior counselor, a senior counselor, a work crew member, a nurse, a tech crew member, somebody in the office, would you please stand up for a moment so we can say thank you? These folks are awesome. Let's give them a round of applause. Yeah, they, you know, so Ryan and I spend a long time. By the way, my name's Karen Shoemaker. For those of you with kids in camp, I'm sure you received a million things from me. And it's such a joy to be part of this whole experience, and it's such a joy to work with the team of folks who just stood up. They are phenomenal, and they're the reason why camp is so awesome. And I'm sure you've heard many stories involving these folks because they're just making camp so great for the kids. And right now, the kids, we're going to change up a little bit. The kids are going to do some sign language for you, and we are going to invite you to sing along. Casey's going to sing, and we're going to invite you to sing along while the kids do sign language to In Christ Alone.
Of peace.
Well done. All right, if you are 4 years old up through second grade, you may come upstairs for children's church. Otherwise, you may go back to your seats. And everyone else out there too, if you are 4 years old, 5 years old, 6 years old, up through second grade, you're invited to meet us in the back and we'll go up for children's church.
Please stand now and join in singing with us, What a Beautiful Name, at number 102 in your books.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God the Lord Most High. You hid in glory in creation, now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name.
friends. You may be seated. Yes, it's Camp Sunday. What a great Sunday it is. Well, it got me thinking. We already heard the campers singing a song. We heard them playing on the drums, which was fantastic. Kathy, you did an amazing job with that. Casey, wonderful job with In Christ Alone. But one of the things that's fun about camp is the opportunity to be able to sing some songs where they're call and response kind of songs. Now, I taught this song to the boys, the younger boys, the other day. And I thought, you know, I'm going to teach the whole church this song because it's a classic camp song. And it's one that just works, right? And you got to snap your fingers if you're going to sing this song. So just snap your fingers, just kind of like this, snap. Nice and slow. You don't want to be too fast, just nice and easy. Easy, slow, 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 slow. There it is, there it is. Now I'm going to start out and you'll just repeat. Thus, call and repeat. Ready? King Jesus is all.
King Jesus is all.
My all in all.
I know he'll answer.
I'm here when I call.
Awoken
by my side. I'm satisfied.
King Jesus is all.
I'm my all in all. Now here's the verse. Well, I went out to seek the Lord. Oh, yeah. I stepped down on his word. Oh, yeah. I prayed my last prayer. Oh, yeah. You know the Holy Ghost met me there. Oh, yeah. Well, I stepped on a rock. The rock was sound. Love a dog came a-tumbling down. The reason I know is saved my soul. I dug down deep and I found pure gold. And he's all, a King Jesus is all, my all in all.
My all in all.
Oh, I know he'll answer.
I'm
here when I call.
Awoken
by my side.
I'm satisfied.
King Jesus is all.
King Jesus is all.
My all. Well, let's take some time to draw our attention to God's truth. I've pulled out a couple passages in Samuel. It's the only way to be able to address this character that we have before us. And if you'd like to follow along, you're going to be jumping through the Pew Bible quite frequently and quite quickly. But we're going to start out at 1 Samuel chapter 14, verses 1 and 2. So hear now God's truth. One day, Jonathan, the son of Saul, said to the young man who carried his armor, "Come, let us go over to the Philistine garrison on the other side." But he didn't tell his dad. Saul was staying in the outskirts of Gibeah in the pomegranate cave at Migron. The people who were with him were about 600 men. And we're going to jump to verse 43 and through 46. Then Saul said to Jonathan, "Tell me, what have you done?" And Jonathan told him, "I tasted a little honey with the tip of my staff that was in my hand. Here I am. I will die." And Saul said, "God do so to me and more also. You surely will die, Jonathan." And the people said to Saul, "Shall Jonathan die, who has worked this great salvation in Israel? Far from it. As the Lord lives, there shall not be one hair of his head to fall on the ground. for he has worked with God this day. So the people ransomed Jonathan so that he did not die. And then we jump to chapter 18, verses 1 to 5. As soon as David had finished speaking to Saul, the soul of Jonathan was knit to the soul of David. And Jonathan loved him as his own soul. And Saul took him that day and would not let him return to his father's house. Then Jonathan made a covenant with David because he loved him as his own soul. And Jonathan stripped himself of the robe that was on him and gave it to David, and his armor, and even his sword, and his bow, and his belt. And David went out and was successful wherever Saul sent him, so that Saul set him over the men of war. And this was good in the sight of all the people, and also in the sight of Saul's servants. We're going to jump to chapter 20. And I'm actually going to pick it up in verse 30, and then do a little hop, skip, and jump at verse 42. Then Saul's anger was kindled against Jonathan, and he said to him, "You son of a perverse, rebellious woman, do I not know that you have chosen the son of Jesse to your own shame and to the shame of your mother's nakedness? For as long as the son of Jesse lives on the earth, neither you nor your kingdom shall be established. Therefore, send and bring him to me, for he shall surely die." Wow. Then Jonathan said to David, "Go in peace, because we have sworn both of us in the name of the Lord, saying, 'The Lord shall be between me and you, and between my offspring and your offspring forever.'" And he rose and departed, and Jonathan went into the city. And then the very last portion I want to read and add it in here is from chapter 31, verses, just a few of them. "Now the Philistines were fighting against Israel, and the men of Israel fled before the Philistines and fell slain on Mount Gilboa. And the Philistines overtook Saul and his sons, and the Philistines struck down Jonathan and Abinadab and Malchishua, the sons of Saul." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's do some praying, my friends. Lord God Almighty, we do thank you so very much for this, your glorious truth, and for the opportunity we have to be gathered here. Lord, we praise you for individuals that stand before us that can inspire us. We give you thanks for opportunities that are placed before us to live into what it means to be a community that celebrates your truth and recognizes our identity with you. So, Lord, even now, as we attend to this, your holy word, we pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations upon our hearts be made acceptable in your sight. For you alone are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, you're seeing it, my friends. You're seeing the counselors. You're seeing the campers. You're not seeing the work crew. Because those work crew, man, they're amazing. Constantly working behind the scenes. They actually embody the I'm Third motto in a major way. But that's the thing that all these individuals are doing. The counselors, translating that into the lives of the campers. The campers seeking earnestly to live into that truth of what it means to be I'm Third. And the work crew manifesting that as they bust a hump, working behind the scenes, cleaning up after all these monkeys. And making sure the tables are put back into order and litter's picked up and things are put in place. Even as the counselors say, "Hey, I need water." There's the work crew ready, well, should be, to respond. It's a good thing. But what is this motto that kind of permeates camp? I'm going to have this group right here remind us. So it's Jesus first. There it is. Jesus first, others second, I'm third. That is so countercultural, right? I mean, these guys are salmon swimming upstream. To be able to lay a seed that gives birth to a healthy idea, to a reality that we all need to understand. And as we're making our way through the second tier characters of 1 and 2 Samuel, we see a character that embodies the I'm third mindset better than any other character in Scripture, Jonathan. So who is this guy, Jonathan, anyway? If you were listening to the Scripture lesson, you'd hear that he was the son of the king. And last week we talked about the king. You know, the people were complaining about to Samuel, saying, your sons are a bunch of ne'er-do-wells. We don't want them. We want a king. So what is it? Samuel goes and anoints this guy who stands head and shoulders above everybody, some smack dog, gorgeous guy. And the next thing you know, there he is. He's the king of Israel. And he has three sons, Jonathan being the oldest, Jonathan, the heir apparent to the throne. Let that sit on you for a little bit. He's the prince of Israel. This is huge. But what do we see about Jonathan's character that becomes so inspirational to us? How is it that Jonathan lived as he embodies this I'm third mindset? Well, we see it in some of the passages that we read here. You know, we can see purely, first and foremost, that he is one who trusts God. Hands down. Everything that he did was embedded in a reality that he was going to trust God and do so in a manner that brought glory to God. The second thing that we see about Jonathan and his character is that he was somebody who was valiant, right? Now, let's be clear about valiant behavior. It's not like total foolish abandonment into trouble or into danger, right? That's not valiant. That's stupid, right? Valiant is the ability to recognize that, yeah, you may face a very frightful and fearful situation, but you're going to step into that with wisdom to be able to bring inspiration to others and deliverance, right, to those who are oppressed. That's what a valiant person does, right? This is Jonathan. He is a trusted friend. I'm telling you what, there's nothing that beats a trusted friend. They're the best. You can just hang with them, you know? You can just walk in the front door. You can go in the side door. You can crawl through the window. It doesn't matter. You're going to your friend's house. And you're going to be able to talk to them and be who you are without any fear of judgment. It's a beautiful thing. Jonathan was respected by his peers because he lived into an I'm third motto, right? And finally, Herbert Lockyer would be one to tell us, an amazing biblical scholar from Scotland, and he identifies Jonathan as the one person in Scripture that most personifies the virtues that Peter writes about in his letter in 1 Peter. Whoa! I mean, so Jonathan is like way up here in the top of the heap. This guy is amazing, right? When it comes to how he's living and how he steps into life and how he reflects the values of what it is that God calls us to be, right? It's amazing. So he reflects all this. It becomes a manifestation because he's embodying the I'm third motto. What is this I'm third motto? How do we understand this? How do we unpack this? Well, to be able to unpack this, we've got to look at our New Testament lesson, and I'm going to just read a portion of it for you so you get a sense of it, right? And Paul writes to the church of Philippi. He says, so if there's any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and one mind. And here it comes. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Three things right there. Jonathan lives into all of them. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Be humble and consider other people's interests over and above your own. Wow. That's the I'm third motto right there. Right? You're going to recognize that God is first in your life and how that is. So, Jonathan, what does he do? Now, I got to tell you, this may seem like a stretch, but it really isn't. When you read the full account of Jonathan's life, I'm going to extract that one story that I read about Jonathan being yelled at by his dad, because that, I believe, reflects that not pursuing selfish ambition or vain conceit. Remember, he's the Prince of Israel. Now, I hope and pray that none of you ever encounter what Jonathan encountered. Think about this. There you are at a fancy dinner that your dad is throwing. Big fancy dinner. Everybody's there except David. And this got King Saul really mad. But Jonathan was there to defend David. Right? So there's no selfish ambition here on Jonathan's behalf. And instantly he saw how his dad was beginning to behave. And I pray that none of you ever have to encounter this kind of trauma in your life, where your dad not only insults you, insults your mother. Now, scripture softens it quite a bit, but use your imagination as to what King Saul actually said about his bride, right? And then on top of that, which I didn't read this portion of it, your dad throws a spear right at your head, right? This is what Jonathan encountered. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. And what Jonathan was willing to endure was the trauma of being insulted, of hearing his mother being defamed, and having his life threatened, physically threatened by his dad. That's some serious trauma right there. And I pray that none of you have to experience that. But Jonathan did, for the sake of his friend. He could have very easily said, you know what, this is ramping up pretty fast here, and you know, I'm just going to throw David under the bus because, you know, maybe Dad's right. What am I doing? Throwing everything away. I'm going to be the king someday after Dad dies. And no, he doesn't do that. Jonathan stands in the face of danger and even ridicule to be able to do that which is honorable. Amazing. Why? Because he trusted God. Where do we see that? We see that in the next instance, in his humility. Right from our first story that we just read from chapter 14. This is a beautiful story. I mean, this is phenomenal. Get the picture here, because the author is making sure that we get this picture. You got Jonathan with his armor bearer. They're hanging out there, right? There's a battle going on. Why is it that the people wanted a king? Because the Philistines keep pressing on them and breathing down their necks and pressuring them and threatening to make them slaves. They wanted a king to push back the Philistines. Well, guess where the king was in our account right here in comparison to Jonathan? He's hanging out under the pomegranate trees, like a big cave of them. He's sitting there twiddling his thumbs, and there's 600 other guys all hanging around waiting for the king to do something. What's the king doing? Eating pomegranates. He's not strategizing. He's not thinking about anything about how do we go and encounter the Philistines who are a threat to us. Who was thinking about it? Jonathan. Jonathan was thinking about it. And Jonathan was an amazing military strategist. Matter of fact, it's even recorded that Jonathan and Saul were constantly sharing ideas with each other. And Jonathan even told David, his buddy, he says, you know, there's nothing that my dad does that I don't know. So there's Jonathan. He knows the talents and the skills that he has and the capacity that God has given to him. And he turns to his armor bearer and he says, dude, let's go. God's with us. And I love this one line in scripture here, man. I'd love to have been Jonathan's armor bearer, because it says right here, it says, Jonathan says, you know, for nothing can hinder the Lord from saving by many or by few. Well, he's recounting what happened with Gideon right there, I'm certain. But here's the reality. You got these two guys, and they're going out. Now, you go a little bit deeper in the story, and you'll hear this thing about, if this happens, then this. If this happens, then this. That's not some magic pixie dust. Sometimes we do that, right? We'll sit there and, well, if this happens, then that means God is doing this, blah, blah, blah. No, that's hooey, right? What is going on here is you've got a guy who knows what he's doing, knows his gifts, knows his skills, and is about to ready to utilize them. Have you ever played chess? Because when you're playing chess, you're thinking in your head all the time of what your opponent's doing. And you think to yourself, if my opponent moves their pawn here, then I'm moving my bishop right here, and it's game over, man. Lights out. That's exactly what Jonathan is doing here with his armor bearer. He's telling him what his moves are. He says, if the Philistines do this, then we're coming in, and we've got them because God has given them to us. And you know what's so fascinating about the essence of humility right here? And this is so vitally important because as Christians, oftentimes we misconstrue humility as being demure, being somebody that's just kind of self-deprecating. No, that is not humility. That is false humility. That's garbage. God did not create you to do mediocre work or to pull back on the reins of what you're capable of doing. God wants to see the very best of you being put to work and being used for his glory and for the furtherance of the community. You just don't sit there and say, I'm going to do this little thing because I know I don't want to appear like I'm being, you know, looking to myself and blah, blah, blah. I don't want to have people drawing attention to myself. Garbage. If God has gifted you to be a scientist, then you be a scientist to the very best of your capacity. If God has gifted you to be a musician, you be the best musician that you possibly can. If God has gifted you to educate, then you're going to educate to the top of your game. Why? So that people can pat you on the back? No. Because humility comes in where you turn that capacity to do what you do to bring glory to God. That's what we're telling these campers with the I'm Third motto. We have these kids going out here and they're learning all kinds of things, from soccer to archery to whatever it is, long jump, nature. And we're expecting them to understand this stuff, to run the 50-yard dash in 7.2. How many of us could run a 50-yard dash in 7.2? You know what? That's a push. But if you've got the talents to run, then run hard. But it's not for your glory. God's given you that gift. Why? To be able to inspire others. To be able to bring about a sense of glory for God. And to be able to get people to go, whoa, no way. Maybe I can do that as well. See, this is what Jonathan does. So sure enough, the Philistines, they went ahead and they made that move. They moved their pawn. And Jonathan says, yes, checkmate. He moved his bishop. And sure enough, next thing you know, here comes Jonathan and here comes his armor bearer. They come up over the crag of the rock and they take out 20 Philistines. I mean, wham, two guys, 20 Philistines down the drain. And the next thing you know, people are watching from the woods, you know, all those little livered chickens hiding out in the trees. They're seeing the Philistines running. They're like, whoa, what's going on, Philistines? They all started come running, and they started chasing the Philistines to the border. Why? Because they were inspired by somebody who is living into their talents for the glory of God. Jonathan wasn't looking for glory for himself. Not at all. Not at all. And he brought the people of Israel to a safe place. It was awesome. And you know what else we see as we go deeper into the story of Jonathan about considering others more than yourself? So we turn the clock forward a little bit. And we all know the story of King David, right? Back when he was a little shepherd boy and taking on Goliath. We read that in chapter 18 right here, the very end of it. The end of that story. So there's David standing before the king. He's, what, 16 years old? How many of you guys here are 16? 15? All right, yeah. That's David, right? And what did David do? As the whole Israelite army is hanging out, knees knocking, shaking, because here comes Goliath, the champion, talking smack on the people of Israel, right? Nobody's willing to take him on. And David looks at him and says, what's wrong with you guys? Don't you know that God is in control here? See, there's this element of trusting God, stepping into what God has given. And God has endowed David with gifts. And what does David do? Not so that he can draw attention to himself. He looked Goliath right in the eye and he said, today, the glory of God will be known. And he ran up to Goliath, slew Goliath, whacked off his head. And the next thing you know, all those lily-livered chickens came out of the woodwork and chased down the Philistines. Where? To the edges of the border again, because it inspired those people to do what God had gifted them to do that the king was not willing to do. Whoa. And so here's David standing before the king. It's just this little shepherd boy. He's probably wearing cargo shorts, you know, a little tank top. Maybe says Galatians on it or something. I don't know. And the next thing you know, he's standing there. He's like, well, I just did something for God. That's what I did. And the king looks at him and says, man, that's an amazing story. And there's Jonathan. Now, why was Jonathan's soul knit to David? I'll tell you why. Because he saw a guy that had a kindred spirit. What is it that Jonathan just did? The exact same thing. He and his armor bearer. But David did it all by himself. And a whole army. That's why Jonathan was in love with David. He's like, man, I just met my best friend. This guy gets it. He knows it. I am connected to this guy. And this is where the humility comes in that we see. And the reality that Jonathan's like, you know what? I'm more concerned about this guy than myself. Takes off his robe, hands it to David. Takes off his sword, hands it to David, gives him his bow, gives him his armor. He says, here, man, that's the prince of Israel, giving away everything that a prince is supposed to hold on to. In essence, saying to David, I defer to you. And what does he do? He defends David, even to the point when David felt like he was in deep, deep trouble because King Saul was chasing him down to take out his life. And sure enough, there it was, Jonathan going and giving words of encouragement to David. No, I will always be with you. I will stand beside you. That's what is I'm third. That's what Jonathan's doing. He's embodying that, thinking about others, recognizing the talents that God has given to him, and bringing glory to God with those and not squelching those talents. He wasn't seeking his own glory. Let me tell you a fun story. Some of you guys may know this story, but I'm going to tell you a story. When I was a director of camps down in Nashville, I introduced the whole summer's best 2 weeks idea to these folks down there. They'd never seen it before. And there's this little boy, fully autistic, had to use a speech bag. His name was Sammy. Now, if I break into tears, bear with me. His mom comes to me and says, I don't know if Sammy's going to be able to, you know, if he's going to be up for being in camp, you know, this athletic camp. And I told her, I said, trust me, Sammy's going to be just fine because of the way we run camp and the way that it is operating under its motto. I said, he'll be fine. Believe me. Well, in the second week of camp, we always have meet week. So you have a swim meet, track meet, other things. So the coach came up to me and said, Ted, what do I do about Sammy for the swim meet? I looked at the coach and I said, well, does Sammy swim? And they said, yeah, Sammy swims. I said, okay. Everybody's in one event before anybody's in two events. And the coach was like, you can't be serious. I said, oh, I'm serious as a heart attack. Put Sammy in. We'll put him in lane one. You put your best swimmers in lane 3 and 4. Everybody knows that. You put your weak swimmers in lane 1 and 6. I said, we'll put all lifeguards. I'll be on the deck. We'll all watch. And the coach said, well, could I get in the water with Sammy? I said, yeah, you can be in the water, but don't you dare touch him. I said, the minute you touch him, and the minute he touches the bottom, the minute he touches the side, the minute he touches the rope, he's DQ'd. Okay. And so there's Sammy. He's signed up. And the clerk of course goes, first call, junior boys, 25-yard freestyle. Next thing you know, here comes Sammy. He reports to the clerk of course. And he's all dolled out. He's got his floaties on. And he's standing there, his big smile. Next thing you know, clerk of course says, second call, junior boys, 25-yard freestyle. Next thing you know, they all line up. They get in the water. The starter goes, swimmers, to your mark. Tweet! And off they go. Sure enough, lane 3 and 4, whoosh, all the way down to the other end in no time flat, even before Sammy even got halfway. But here's where it gets cool. You want to talk about the third, I'm third motto being lived into and embodied by a camp? This is when it happened, and I was so moved to tears, I could hardly stand it. It was amazing. I look up in the stands, there's Sammy's mom and dad with tears streaming down their face because they never thought that their son would ever be engaged in such a high level of competition and being engaged in that kind of world where an entire camp is cheering for Sammy. And the lane 3 and 4 swimmers who finished first and second, by the way, got out of the water, walked over to lane 1, stood beside me as we're looking at Sammy coming down the lane. And we're going, come on, Sammy, all of them. And there are the coaches going, and there's the one coach in the water whispering in his ear, you can do it, Sammy, you can do it, Sammy. And Sammy swims, and just like Mark Phelps, boom, I've never seen a stronger touch. He was so into it. He touched that wall so strong. Bam, he slapped it down. Timer stopped him. And I pulled him up out of the water and I said, Sammy, look what you just did. You just swam 25 yards. The whole camp erupts into just cheers. And we gave glory to God. Because it wasn't about the winner. It wasn't about how great anybody was. It's about a community coming together and supporting one another and celebrating who it is that God's called us to be. God first, others second, yourself third. The I'm third motto. So my friends, how are you going to embody that the rest of this summer? Amen.
And God, thank you that you even gave us a communal prayer that you taught your disciples that's been passed on from age to age. And so we pray that prayer now together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As we continue our worship, we get a chance to think about the blessings we've been given, and we give back to God out of our time, our talent, and our treasure. So in just a second, the band will do an offertory for us, but I'm going to pray for that offering beforehand. So let's bow our head one more time. God, we thank you for the many blessings that you give us. And God, we ask that as we give back out of our time, our talent, and our treasure, that you would use us and that you would use these gifts so that people in this community and communities around the world would come to know of that love you have for them and transformation may take place. We pray this in your name. Amen.
Hold it all together. Everybody needs you strong. But life hits you out of nowhere and barely leads you holding on. And when you're tired of fighting, chained by your control. There's freedom in surrender. Lay it down and let it go. So when you're on your knees and answer seems so far away, you're not alone. Stop holding on and just be held. Your world's not falling apart, it's falling into place. I'm on the throne. Stop holding on and just be held. Just be. Just be held.
If your eyes are on the storm, you'll wonder if the love is still. But if your eyes are on the cross, you know I always have and I always will. And not a tear is wasted inside. When you're on your knees and answers seem so far away, you're not alone. Stop holding on and just be held. Your world's not falling apart, it's falling into place. I'm on the throne. Stop holding on and just be held. Just be.
Sometimes in life there isn't a resolution. But that's a nice resolution right there. But we go out into the world because we know there is a resolution ultimately. And we bear witness to that hope. And we go forth and we radiate what? Jesus first.
Lord second, I am third.
Oh, friends, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, let the people of God say,
amen. Just be.